So we want good neighborly relations with India, we want peace with India, we want friendship with India, but that peace and friendship must be a peace of honor. It must be a peace of a self-respecting sovereign state. India must accept that. India must know that peace can only be established on the basis of self-respect and honor, on the basis of our own commitments, on the basis of our own pledges, on the basis of our own promises to the people of Pakistan, to the people of India, to the world at large, and above all to the people of Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir is not an integral part of India. It has never been an integral part of India. Jammu and Kashmir is a disputed territory between India and Pakistan. It is more a part of Pakistan than it can ever be with India, with all her eloquence and with all her extravagance with words. The people of Jammu and Kashmir, sir, are part of people of Pakistan. In blood, in flesh, in life, kith and kin of ours, in culture, in geography, in history, in every way and in every form, irrespective of our size, of our resources. We shall fight to the end, but we shall fight in self-defense. We shall fight for honor. We are not aggressors. We are victims of aggression. It was the duty of the Security Council to pronounce on who is the aggressor and who is the aggressed. It was Pakistan that was the victim of aggression. And I am not referring here to some of the remarks made by countries which have no right to be here. They are not even countries. But I am referring to the great powers. I am referring to all peace-loving countries. I'm referring to those who believe in the cause of justice, in the cause of righteousness, in the cause of honor. After all, history is not in vain. Wars have been fought in the past. People have upheld great causes. We believe more than ever before that justice is bound to prevail. That the people of Jammu and Kashmir, 5 million people, sir, must have a right to decide their own future. Why should they be made an exception? The whole phenomenon of self-determination stretching from Asia and Africa should apply to the whole world except to the people of Jammu and Kashmir. Are they some outcasts of an Indian society? Are they some untouchable pariahs that they should not be given the right of self-determination, that they should not be allowed to have a right to their own future? The great country of France, they have permitted the Algerians to have the right of self-determination. It is a Wilsonian concept, the right of self-determination. The Soviet Union believes in the right of self-determination of all peoples. The whole world believes in the right of self-determination, and must it be denied to the people of Jammu and Kashmir merely because power must prevail over principle? Power shall never prevail over principle. Finally and ultimately, principle must prevail over power. This is a Christian concept. It is an Islamic concept. It is a civilized concept. And those nations who do not believe in such concept, they must face the ultimate consequence. Secretary of State of the United States of America, Mr. Dean Rusk, said that the historical position is a plebiscite in Kashmir. On the one hand, you have the whole world arrayed on the cause of right and justice and morality. On the other hand, you have a war machine, an arrogant and a chauvinistic state, breaking its pledges, breaking its promises, and wanting to destroy the will and the spirit of our people. The will and the spirit of our people can never be destroyed, Mr. President. Let me tell you, sir, you can have one ceasefire, you can have another ceasefire, but the 100 million people of Pakistan shall face extermination rather than to allow to forsake their principles to be negated and destroyed by sheer force and power. So, in response to the call of international peace and international goodwill, we have ordered our troops, provided India agrees, to a cessation of hostilities. But sir, a cessation of hostilities is not enough. You must now address yourself as the Security Council, as the most important organ of the United Nations, to the heart of the problem. For 18 years you have played and toyed with the future of Kashmir. You cannot any longer play and toy and make a plaything out of 5 million people. It is your moral responsibility, that of the Security Council, to address itself to a meaningful and a lasting solution of the problem of Jammu and Kashmir. The Security Council has been seized of this problem for 18 years. We have more documentation, more resolutions on Jammu and Kashmir, the most fundamental problem that faces the world today, than any other problem. Is that not ironical? That a conflict which may lead to world conflagration, and the present situation has shown that it is possible for this conflict to lead to world conflagration. With that, the Security Council has shown its lethargy. It has shown its indolence. We have decided that on the one hand, we give the United Nations a last opportunity to determine what it can do for a purposeful and a peaceful settlement, a lasting settlement of the problem of Jammu and Kashmir, and we give it a time limit. We will, within a certain period of time, if the Security Council is not able to determine and decide on the future, on the responsibilities which are placed on it, on its honor under the Charter, which believes in self-determination, then Pakistan will have to withdraw from the United Nations. And I am not giving this in the form of an ultimatum. I am saying this as I am honor-bound to respect the very purposes of the Charter. Pakistan, in leaving the United Nations, will be fulfilling the Charter of the United Nations. And then, sir, you will have one-third or more of the world outside your organ, and you'll have some states which call themselves states as members of the Security Council. I thank you.